On July 19th, 2024, if you had a Windows computer at home or maybe used one at work, chances are you saw this and were unable to even boot up your machine. Well, you're not alone. At all. In fact, this strange bug has suddenly been hitting millions of computers all around the world, including ones that contain very sensitive information. In fact, it seems that this bug is primarily affecting machines that do have sensitive information, or at least serve vital roles for operating many businesses or even government facilities. For that reason, a lot of people started to think that this was some kind of global cyber attack. But in reality, this was all the result of a bug, quite simple in nature and frustratingly super avoidable. It all came through an update from a cybersecurity company called CrowdStrike, which has their software Falcon installed on the computers of nearly half of the world's Fortune 500 companies. Airports, banks, hospitals, coffee shops, the DMV, all experienced outages for several days, some of them still experiencing them right now. People missed flights, couldn't access their money, get medical attention, very serious stuff. Just about every field of the global economy had at least one company affected by this bug in some way. Many journalists and IT professionals are calling this the modern Y2K, and could even be one of the greatest outages in history. So what happened? Now I want to be clear, this is not an attack video on CrowdStrike. This video is just meant to be a simplification of what is already being publicly said right now. We technically don't know the full story of what happened, so these are technically theories and educated guesses, but I'm just the messenger. Everything in this video is alleged. Now, the cause of this bug was likely just oversight and negligence. To provide some background, CrowdStrike creates security software, and one of their products, known as Falcon, was the main culprit of this outage. Think of Falcon as Windows Defender or Malwarebytes on steroids. It is very intricately designed. It can spot and catch malware before it even infects a machine much better than a traditional antivirus can. This is mainly because of how deep in the computer this program operates. Unlike most over-the-counter antivirus desktop programs that operate at the user level, Falcon operates at the kernel level. Think of the kernel as the heart of the operating system, the epicenter, the common ancestor of virtually every task and calculation that occurs inside your computer is the operating system's kernel. The kernel essentially oversees everything software-related. It has more power and more freedom to make decisions because it is communicating directly with the hardware. The vast majority of computer programs do not operate at the kernel level, and having this separation and hierarchy is important for a couple of reasons. Firstly, if your standard application encounters some kind of critical error, the kernel overseeing it can immediately kick into plan B. Let's say some crazy glitch ends up happening in Google Chrome. The kernel will go, okay, we're gonna shut down Chrome by force so that this error doesn't get worse and so that the computer can continue operating as normal. This is what happens when a program crashes. The operating system is essentially saying, all right, I'm in charge now, you're causing way too many problems. Which effectively leads to the second reason for why we need this separation. It creates security and stability issues otherwise. If, for whatever reason, Google Chrome was operating at the kernel level, that would mean it would have the same power and permissions as the kernel itself. So the kernel wouldn't exactly have as much of a say in shutting down the application if some kind of glitch occurred, which would ultimately cause a critical error in the machine and prevent it from even booting up. For this reason, the kernel is very sensitive, and even the tiniest oopsies can have dire consequences. When a glitch does occur at the kernel level, we call this a kernel panic, which ends up shutting down the machine by force, and any unsaved data ends up being lost. In other words, you do not mess with the kernel. So naturally, Microsoft takes third-party kernel drivers very seriously, so much so that they offer something called WHQL certificates, short for Windows Hardware Quality Labs. It is basically a very complicated process full of red tape regulation and rigorous testing and debugging that ensures that the program in question is stable enough to operate deep within Windows. Programs that are not WHQL certified are riskier because they haven't gone through all these tests. These are known as a test signed drivers. CrowdStrike Falcon is WHQL certified, so customers can feel confident installing this program to their computer and not having to worry about potential problems because, hey, even Microsoft trusts it. Having Falcon operate within the kernel allows it to spot and contain virtually all possible threats. Threats that otherwise may not be possible to detect at the user level, because this program is effectively working at the binary level. This allows CrowdStrike's program to provide insanely good security, but that comes at a great cost. If CrowdStrike makes a mistake, then they can screw up the entire machine. And that is exactly what happened. By the very nature of the program's design, CrowdStrike Falcon basically has to provide updates by force. These are known as over-the-air updates. This is because if they offered, say, volunteer updates that you just click to install, it gives malware developers more transparency than they should have. You want these updates to be unpredictable. And with over-the-air, the program is basically updating without the user even knowing it. And because Falcon wants these updates to occur as quickly as possible, something like earning a WHQL certificate with each update would delay things. So while this new updated driver was certified, it was still downloading and executing additional code that wasn't. I'm not going to speculate in this video on why CrowdStrike would do this because we technically don't know. But because these additional tests didn't occur, these bugs weren't caught. Now, I'll be candid and say that I am not an expert in how the kernel of an operating system works, but from what I understand with my research, the bug basically did this. One of the .sys files that was included in the update had a bunch of erroneous code inside of it. Heck, it was hardly even code at all. In the simplest words, it was basically a file containing a bunch of zeros, which don't really mean anything. And this new CrowdStrike update contained code that was pointing to this file, telling the machine to do something with it. So when the user would power on their computer, CrowdStrike, in the background, was trying to access that information in that file. But there's nothing there. It's trying to access a memory that doesn't exist. The program doesn't know what to do, and because it's operating at the kernel level, it just crashes everything, and you are now stuck in this boot loop. Because the computer can't boot, CrowdStrike can't just roll back the update. Instead, each computer, one by one, has to have this update manually removed by an IT professional. Considering that this bug has hit an estimated 8.5 million computers, this is going to take a very long time to fix. Until then, these computers can't even turn on. Imagine all the sensitive data and crucial programs that the average Joe can't even access right now to operate their business. This entire event really is a much bigger deal than most people think. If you remember or at least know about the Y2K scare, this event is basically a tiny, I use the word tiny loosely, tiny snapshot of what that would have looked like. I've already done a video on Y2K, so I'll keep this short. But basically, in the 90s, computers took track of time in a different way than they do now. So it was discovered that on January 1st, 2000, computers would get confused and instead read the date as January 1st, 1900. This would mess up a ton of calculations on all the computers around the world. They would malfunction and wreak havoc. And because this was the 90s, you couldn't just easily download an OS update online. These computers had to, one by one, be manually updated through a floppy disk, CD-ROM, whatever. Y2K was not fake, it was avoided. We thankfully caught the problem in enough time where we were able to update nearly all these computers where it wasn't an issue. Some computers were affected and they did some crazy things, but the sun still came up in the morning. Now, the number of computers that would have been affected by Y2K in the 90s was way bigger compared to the ones affected by CrowdStrike, which is why I say tiny snapshot. But in this case, we didn't catch a bug. A bug was just created out of thin air. So what about fixing it? Well, first, here is a word about a fine product. Have you ever been in a situation where you thought, oh, that looks cool, I want to try that, but I don't know how? Well, that's what Skillshare is for. If you've ever wanted to learn more about doing a certain hobby or passion, Skillshare has everything you need to not only learn how to become a pro, but to even turn the thing you love to do most into something profitable. Each course is led by industry standard professionals who provide all the help and resources needed to make sure that you succeed. It's no secret that I'm an aspiring filmmaker, but set dressing can get quite expensive, especially if you're just one of the small guys. But Skillshare has an amazing course on Blender, a free program that allows you to build entire worlds photorealistic using 3D models. Advanced movie making has never been cheaper. I also want to learn a lot more about cooking. I've been cooking a lot at home lately, and I only want to get better at it and try recipes that I thought would be impossible to make. But Skillshare makes it easy. I've even created a list of other courses that I want to complete so I can apply them to my work and even everyday life. And you can do the same thing as well. The first 500 people who sign up for Skillshare with my link will get their first month completely free. That is one whole month to just go nuts and learn whatever you want. Yeah, so check out Skillshare, and a special thanks to them for sponsoring this video. So how can you fix and avoid the CrowdStrike outage? Well, luckily there's a bunch of guides online that show you how to do this. You basically open Windows in something called safe mode, where you then open something called command prompt and enter a series of commands that would manually delete the offending .sys files, which sounds simple on its own, but this also involves having to create backups of your hard drive and continuously mounting and demounting it. This also doesn't take into account computers that have their data completely encrypted by third-party companies that require a special password to even access the machine. The computers that contain those passwords and grant access to those machines are also down. So you then have to take another set of steps that involves manually getting the keys that grant those computers access. It's such a mess. Your average employee that only knows how to use Microsoft Word is not going to know what to do. But the good news is that Microsoft just created a program that you can download onto a USB or disk, which can then be inserted into the computer and just delete it all for you, much like all those Y2K updates in days of old. Now again, this has caused a lot of upset within the tech space, with people wondering how CrowdStrike could have let this happen. Some are even pointing the finger at Microsoft as well, wondering how they would allow a certified driver to run code that isn't certified. This outage pretty much only affected Windows. Apple stopped giving Falcon kernel access in 2020, so macOS machines were not affected. In fact, I didn't even know about this outage until like 2 hours after it hit the news because I'm a Mac user, and the Windows machine I do have does not use CrowdStrike. Now, Linux is a much more flexible OS when it comes to kernel access, so this issue even affected Linux machines not that long ago. But because their market share is so small relative to these other systems, the effect it have was negligible. I've been hearing the argument tossed around that the reason this outage, or even cyber attacks in general, primarily have affected Windows is because Windows is just not as secure as it could be. And while I do believe that's true, I also think it has a lot to do with the popularity of Windows. The market share Windows has in the computing world is unmatched. So malware developers are obviously going to target the most popular software with arguably the most vulnerabilities, because they want to create as much destruction as possible. It's not that Macs don't get viruses, it's that nobody cares about macOS. There's not enough people using it where a virus would be interesting, and it's also much more locked down. But in Windows' case, even something that is just a mistake with no malice intended can still have huge consequences. Which leads me to what I think is the best way we can avoid things like this going forward. Diversifying your digital environment. Use multiple operating systems on one machine if possible. Most versions of Linux are completely free. If, heaven forbid, an outage like this occurs on Windows again, you could boot into the Linux partition of your hard drive and continue using your computer. Granted, Linux doesn't have the same level of software support as Windows, so some things will be missing, but for the average office employee that only needs to use their web browser, it will suffice in the meantime. On Mac computers, you can use Bootcamp Assistant or Parallels Desktop so that it can also boot into Windows. It's also important to, collectively, diversify the software you are using. When you have a company as big as CrowdStrike, you have great influence, which can be extremely rewarding if you accomplish something positive. But if you make just one mistake, that level of power can then manifest into something negative, like halting a chunk of the global economy. If you were to encourage competing businesses to also take a larger piece of the pie, you can in turn alleviate all the collateral that comes with an outage like this. You don't want to put all your OS and antivirus eggs in one basket, so to speak. Think of it like a stock portfolio. You don't want to invest everything in the same company, because if that company's stock tanks, your entire portfolio tanks. Instead, you want to invest a little bit in one company, a little in another, so that if one of those stocks crashes, it is only a minor dent for you. Just like if YouTube were to have an outage tomorrow, That would be very bad, because YouTube's market share in the online video space is crazy, and so people would have almost nothing substantial to watch online, outside of maybe TikTok. But if CNN were to have an outage tomorrow, people could just migrate over to ABC News, CBS, NBC. There are options. It's not like the news market is now completely gutted, because the market share between these respective companies is comparable. I think a similar approach could be taken with software. So maybe 25% of the market is CrowdStrike, 15% SentinelOne, 18% Cisco,
and 2% Butterscotch Ripple.
That's 105%.
Any good?
But instead, you have just one company controlling the technological infrastructure of nearly half of the most powerful companies in the world. Now, I'm not saying you should uninstall CrowdStrike or that we should enforce legislation that penalizes a company just for being too popular. I'm simply saying that if we were in a perfect world where you could have more decently supported competitors to choose from and could lower the huge influence of one company without resistance, the blow of an outage would not be as severe, because now only some of the airports would have the outage, not all of them. You just gotta diversify, people. If you only use Microsoft Windows your whole entire life, Windows bugs are gonna affect you a lot more. I want software to look like cars on the road, where just about every single one is a different make. Despite the calamity this outage has caused, there is a lot to be learned from it. It shows that despite the crazy, sophisticated things that computers are able to do, whether it's artificial intelligence or curing tons of diseases, it is still all made by humans at the end of the day, and human beings make mistakes. In many respects, these incredible leaps in mankind are really just a very elaborate house of cards. All it takes is one tiny thing to have it all tumbling down, and the only option left is to pick up the pieces. And also supporting me on Patreon, of course. Patreon.com/NationSquid. As well as buying me a coffee if you're oh so inclined. I do love my coffee. A special thanks to my patrons and channel members for making this video possible. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you never miss a future video.